I have the honor of introducing Shari Ballard. Shari is the Senior Executive Vice President and President of U.S. Retail for Best Buy. Let me share a little bit about Shari's impressive background. After graduating from the University of Michigan, Shari started at her local Best Buy store as an assistant manager. She rose to general manager, and that was just the beginning. From store manager, Shari was promoted to a variety of leadership roles at Best Buy and became executive vice president of human resources and legal. In 2007, Shari assumed responsibility for all of Best Buy's stores in the U.S. In 2010, she was promoted to President of the Americas, U.S. and Mexico. 2 years later, she became President of International, overseeing business and transformational efforts in Canada, China, Europe, and Mexico. In 2014, 2 years into Best Buy's current transformation, Renew Blue, Shari assumed the role of President of U.S. Retail and Chief Human Resources Officer. Shari has been named to Fortune's 50 Most Powerful Women in Business multiple years running and was featured in an article in Fortune titled, The Women Who Saved Best Buy. And what a transformation it has been. Almost 1,433 of the U.S. stores have been redesigned. Retail employees have been put through retraining boot camp. They have become a force in e-commerce. They've removed $1 billion in annual cost, and earnings have exceeded Wall Street's expectations 11 quarters in a row. Since 2012, the stock has almost tripled. Best Buy is one of the most impressive turnarounds in retail in over the last decade, says Scott Galloway, marketing professor at NYU. Please join me in giving a warm University of Minnesota welcome to tonight's speaker, Shari Ballard.
Thank you. Thanks, Bill. Hello, everybody. Thank you, Jill. It's actually an honor to be here. Jill, which I think you guys heard in the beginning, worked at Best Buy forever, did a fabulous job for us, complete icon. And me and a whole bunch of other people totally admire Jill. So having the chance to be here with you all and having the chance to be here with Jill is a real treat. So thank you very much for having me. Now, having spent the vast majority of my life on the other end of this type of situation, sitting where you guys are sitting, getting ready to listen to somebody like me, on a topic that I'll cover in just a second, I cannot imagine that at 7:21 at night, when most of you have either just eaten or haven't eaten at all. Let's take a little poll. How many of you have not even eaten yet? Okay, and the other half have eaten before you come. All right, so the idea that I'm going to stand up here for an hour and go through 100 pages of PowerPoint slide with my vast perspective on the world is probably very unappealing to you all. It's unappealing to me as well because, number one, I don't find myself interesting enough to talk for an hour nonstop. And number two, I know for a fact at 7:21 with half of you just having eaten, I would lose you 15 minutes in, and we don't want that either. So I thought what I would do is give you a perspective on the topic that Jill has asked me to talk about, which is retail careers and some key questions around retail careers, like what kind of opportunity is out there. What's it really like once you get into a retail career? Should everybody want to be a buyer, or is there life beyond being a buyer? And she asked me to share my career a little bit as well. So I'll cover all of that, I promise. So that's the topic. I'll give you a perspective on it. And then, as Jill said, I think we'd be better off with me hearing what questions you guys have. And then together, we'll shape the rest of the discussion based on more of what's forefront in your mind than what I come preloaded with. Does that work for you guys? Excellent, because I have no plan B. All right, so two things then, a brief introduction and then a story. So as Jill said, I started out with Best Buy in 1993. I grew up in Michigan, just a little bit south of Flint in the middle of the state. My dad worked for General Motors on the line. My mom was a stay-at-home mom. And I was the first person in our family to go to college. And so probably like many of you, I had to work while I was going to school, and that's where I got my first retail job. And then years later, I joined Best Buy and decided after I graduated from school that I wanted to find out whether or not I could be a good store manager or not, and that I would go into retail only long enough to get the answer to these questions, and then I would leave retail and get a real job. So that was the idea I had. And 23 years later, that's still my game plan. Okay, so that's what we've got. But I don't actually want to, I don't want to start tonight talking to you guys about Best Buy, although in the Q&A, I would be happy to answer anything you got for me there. I actually want to talk to you about my very first retail job. And I want to talk to you about my first retail job because I think it answers all the questions Jill asked me, and it also answers, in my view, what the most important aspect is, not only of work in retail and any one of the various jobs you could do in retail, but I think it also answers more questions about careers and life and what it is that we should all be pursuing in the time we spend in our careers and away from our family and the people we love. So here's the backdrop. My first job in retail was working for a very small regional sporting goods company called MC Sporting Goods, which probably none of you have heard of. So let me give you a way to visualize it. You guys know Dick's Sporting Goods, right? Give me a sense. Everybody's got Dick's Sporting Goods? Okay, excellent. So think Dick's Sporting Goods, smaller, let's call it a third the size of Dick's Sporting Goods, and almost no women's clothing. Okay, so that was MC Sporting Goods. And so that's where I worked while I was going to college. Now, one of the things that I noticed while I was there was that MC was a lot like other retailers in that the management turnover in MC Sporting Goods was relatively high, as it can be in retail sometimes. But one of the things that was, I think, a little bit more unique about MC was the turnover on the team members who worked in the store, like myself, wasn't really that high. It was a pretty stable core group of us that were working there. And for the most part, we were all doing the same thing. We were going to college, and MC was really good about working around our schedules. And so we had a core group of people that were there. We were pretty stable. The managers turned a fair amount. And one of the things that became fairly evident early on in my time there, and I worked there the whole time I was going to school, was that I would say first and foremost, my own level of excitement about leaving class at the end of a day and going to work, I would say probably the translation of that into how well we did or didn't serve our customers every day, and the translation of that into how well we did or didn't perform financially, ebbed and flowed as the days went, and it was based a lot on one factor, who the manager was for the day. So we were all similar, the managers changed. And so you could kind of see that. And the way it showed up for me, and it's like most things, as you get older, you get language for things. I'm sure I didn't have it at the time. But at the time, the way it showed up for me was when a certain manager was there, I'd finished school, and I was going to school full-time too and working full-time. So I'd finish school, I'd be ready to go to work, the day would go fast, be done, go home, excellent. You're not checking your watch 100 times during the day. Other times, you're trying to think of the 500th excuse for why you can call in sick that day. You're trying to track off what illnesses have I already used and not used, and you're looking for all your reasons to not go to work, and if you are there, you're looking at your watch a whole bunch of the time because it's not going too fast. Do you guys have a gist of what I'm talking about here, like the difference between the two? Okay, perfect. So that started to become a little bit evident. But over time, what became actually more evident was that the performance of the store, the way the store felt, how that translated, changed an awful lot based on who the store manager was. I'm going to compare and contrast it for you for a minute. So there was a guy who worked there not too long after I started, and I'm going to call him Bill because I see a camera right there, and so real names, probably not that great. So let's call him Bill, okay? So Bill was the store manager, and the way I would describe Bill, the store manager, was that he was a very competent retail manager. So he knew all the things that you have to do to actually make a retail store work. And MC was very good about this. So he knew how to set an ad. He knew how to write a schedule, how to count down a till, how to unload a truck. Store had to be open at close. So all the tasks associated with running a store, Bill knew how to do. And he knew how to do it well. And so the way it would basically work when Bill was our store manager was you would come in, you'd punch in, you'd check in with him or one of his managers. You'd get your assigned tasks to complete for the day. You'd go do your assigned task. You'd wait on customers in between. And then you would check with him or one of his assistants, whoever was on duty. They would come and kind of look at whether or not you got the tasks done well or not. Give you feedback on, no, I need you to do that, or yeah, that's okay. And if it's good, out you go. Punch out. That was basically how it went. There's no major drama to the story, so he wasn't an ogre or anything like that. And like I said, he knew the kind of technical stuff that you have to know to actually run a good store. What I will say is I don't remember at any point in time working with him where he ever really asked any questions. Didn't do small talk. I think his statement to question ratio had to be as high as anybody on the planet. So lots of statements, not that many questions. And I think for the most part, the way he saw his job was he knew how to run a retail store, and his job was to, we were kind of the tools to get that done, so he would kind of tell us, here's what you do, then we would go do it, and that's it. I don't think he believed in any way, shape, or form that he needed our brains for anything, or that we could potentially have any insight on much. It was more just get it done. Like I said, he wasn't rude about it or anything, but that was just kind of how it went. So that was the experience. I contrast that with the guy who came in after Bill, and a little bit after I'd been there for a number of years. His name and his real name was Larry. Now, Larry was equally as competent technically as Bill was. So he knew all the same stuff about how the store had to run, etc. Larry spent a disproportionate amount of his time not giving you direction on tasks, although he certainly did that. But he spent a disproportionate amount of his time asking questions, on the floor, always picking your brain about something, always got something in his mind he's trying to solve, some customer issue he's trying to understand, and was on the floor, engaged with the team, always asking questions. Let me give you an example. So I'm standing out on the sales floor one day, and at this point I've been working there, I'm directionally correct here, but I'm making this up a bit. Let's call it 3 years-ish in my tenure at MC Sporting Goods. So at that point, I'd seen a fair number of things. So I'm standing out on the sales floor, and I'm in front of about 24 linear feet of soccer shin guards. And at this point, I'm probably either like a supervisor or a full-timer in a department we called athletics. Okay, if you guys think ball sports, though, football, basketball, soccer, etc., that was the department. Okay, so I'm standing in front of 24 linear feet of soccer shin guards, 4-foot gondolas. They're merchandised by style, and they're color blocked. You guys got a visual? You're either in this profession, like, you know retail, so you got a visual, okay? So it's like soft soccer shin guards, vertical red, vertical yellow, vertical black, and we got it for 24 feet. So I'm standing there, and Larry comes walking up one day. And he says, Shari, you spend a lot of time over here. I need to ask you something. Fire away, Larry. Because he's always doing it, you know? He's like always on, Tom, what do you think about this? What do you think about this? So go ahead, Larry. So he says, our performance in class whatever, subclass whatever, subclass 992, which was basically the equivalent of soccer shin guards, is terrible. It's terrible relative to budget. It's terrible relative to the rest of the stores. It's terrible. Do you have any idea whatsoever? Any insight? Nothing's too crazy here. Any idea on what we could do to do a better job and raise our performance in soccer shin guards? And I'll take anything. So I give him whatever the probably 22-year-old version is of Shari Ballard, which is somewhat like you're looking at right now, I'm guessing, but this is the polished version. Okay, so you imagine 22-year-old version, I give him the biggest eyeball roll in the history of mankind, and I say, yeah, Larry, we could get some red soft soccer shin guards in. How about if we try that? So Larry does a couple things that I've grown to appreciate as I've gotten older. Number one, he completely ignores the manner with which the feedback is delivered. Okay, so he completely ignores the eyeball roll, steps aside, lets that go, completely ignores the attitudinal delivery of the feedback, and instead says, what do you mean? And I said, what do you mean, what do I mean, Larry? If you want our performance to be better, how about if we get some red soccer shin guards in? He says, no. Like, what is the problem? I said, the problem is the same thing the problem is every year that I've been here. Every single year, the same thing happens. The week before soccer practice starts, the moms and the shorties come in. They want red soft soccer shin guards. For whatever reason, the teams around our store are disproportionately red. And by the end of the first day, we're out. By the time we get them back in, it's too late. Practice has started. So if you want to know how we can do a better job in soccer shin guards, let's get some red. So Larry says, well, what do you guys do? I said, what do you mean, what do we do? He says, well, what do you do when we're out and a customer comes in and that's what they need? I said, what do you think we do? We give them the best possible customer service. What do you guys think we did? What do you think we did? Fire away. No, we were not that good. Did you guys hear? I'm sorry we're out. I can see if I can order some. We were not even close to that sophisticated. Try again. What do you think we did? Exactly. Shanice is on it. We sent them across the street to Herman's Sporting Goods, who apparently understood that we were disproportionately red in our community. They understood supply and demand, and we shuffled customers over to Herman's Sporting Goods all day long. And so Larry's head is almost exploding at the idea of this. And so I said, what do you want us to do? He said, well, can't you sell them something different? I said, no. I mean, they are red. We cannot sell them green. So this is our problem, not their problem. So Larry says, okay, this cannot happen. Stop. Off the sales floor we go. We walk into the warehouse of the MC Sporting Goods in Flint, Michigan. Now, it's a warehouse that looks just like every other retail warehouse in the history of mankind, so it's racking everywhere. It's got the swinging metal doors. We walk back there, we turn around, and there's a beige-colored phone hanging on the wall. And next to the beige-colored phone is an 8.5 by 11 laminated sheet of paper tacked up, and it's got a bunch of names and phone numbers on it. And the phone itself, and whoever thought of putting beige in a warehouse, is that's a whole separate design school problem, but there's a beige phone in the warehouse, and it's one of those deals where at one point the cord on it was like 300 feet long, but the cord's all wound up super tight now, and so it looks, you guys got a visual of that? Now, I have to actually check this because I'm looking at the age of some of you, and I'm wondering whether you actually know what a phone with a cord looks like. Because I think I might have to update my example. Do you guys get the gist of it? Okay, so there it is. So we turn around and we look up, and Larry goes down the list, and essentially the list is of all the corporate office people for MC Sporting Goods who are in Grand Rapids, Michigan. And he goes down and he finds the guy who's the buyer of athletics, Bobby. So he picks up the phone, he dials it, and he hands me the phone, and I'm standing in the warehouse. My manager Larry's here. I got the beige-colored phone in my hand. The phone rings, and this is where people think I might actually be lying, but Bobby actually answered the phone. So yes, buyers do answer phones sometimes. So Bobby answers the phone. Hello, he says. I say, hey, Bobby, it's Shari from the MC Sporting Goods in Flint. My manager, Larry, wanted me to call you. I mean, what do you say? I have no idea. So Bobby says, okay, what can I do for you, Shari? So I explained the situation, and I said, you know, I think we need some red soccer shin guards. My manager, Larry, wanted me to tell you this. So Bobby either makes the smartest decision in the history of supply chain management or the stupidest, depending on how you want to calculate the analytics around it. But the next day, we get, I don't know how many boxes of red soccer shin guards, a lot. On the shelf they go. We start selling through them. Inventory levels reset, our soccer sales go up, that's the deal. Now here's what's important about the story. The vast majority of the stuff that we came up with while Larry was picking our brains on how to make the business better, how to make the customer service better, how to make our store perform better, the vast majority of the things that we came up with were things that were absolutely 100% in our control in the store. But this is what Larry habitually did. He would, sometimes on Saturday, he'd let us come in and he would teach us how the P&L worked. He didn't have to do any of this. But we're all going to school. You know, it's a multi-million dollar business, and we're learning all this stuff. Well, this was Larry. That's how Larry led. Larry's question to statement ratio was the exact opposite of Bill's, probably 20 questions for every one statement. And the most fundamental difference between the two managers was not their technical skill. It was what they actually believed their job was. And what they actually believed about the people on the team. Bill saw the people on the team as tools to get done the stuff that he knew had to be done. That's what he did. Larry saw every single person on our 24-ish person team as having some unique insight, something to add that he was missing as the store manager, and absolutely believed that everybody on the team had something to contribute beyond their hands. He actually believed we had brains. He actually believed we had brains that might see something that he missed or that our team in Grand Rapids, Michigan missed, and they were good. So it's not like, you know, we had a group of people there that didn't know what they were doing, but he actually believed that we had value to add for who we were, what we could see that he couldn't, and he did a fabulous job of orchestrating it nonstop in service of what we were trying to do for our customers and to grow our business in a way that it created opportunity for people on the team. That's what he believed, and he acted that way. Now, when Bill was our store manager, I'm going to need some editing help with that one. When Bill was our store manager, we were probably, I'm going to say like probably middle of the pack in performance in MC. I mean, it wasn't one of those things where it was so bad that like somebody would have noticed something's askew here. In fact, most people probably thought it was just fine. When Larry was our store manager, same group of people, different leadership point of view, different level of what we would today call engagement, but it's too much of a buzzword, but I mean like real engagement. And we were one of the top performing companies in the store, or one of the top performing stores in the company. It was at the time, something I've come to appreciate later, it was a beautiful, beautiful case study. Because nothing was different between Bill and Larry in the mechanics of the business. Nothing. The people were the same. The pricing strategy was the same. The ad strategy was the same. The assortment was the same. The design of the store was the same. All of it, the hours of the store were the same. Everything was the same, except for who the leader was and what they actually thought their job was. And importantly, how they used the talent of their team. Larry was a pro at creating an environment where people like me, 21 years old, first real job, actually believed I had some insight that could help grow a multi-million dollar business. He believed it, so I believed it. And so did the other 20-some people in the store. And we grew the business exponentially as a result. Now, my life took me outside of MC. I told you I joined Best Buy from there. But the same pattern has held everywhere. One of the first jobs I had, about 3 years in, I guess, to Best Buy, I'd been a store manager for us, and we were working on implementing a new business model in the stores. And the way we did change implementation at Best Buy at the time was very sophisticated. We defined everything in a manual. We mailed it out to the store managers, of which I was one of them. We sent us to a Sunday night training for 2 hours where we were supposed to learn all the new ways we're going to run the store. We sent us back, gave us a checklist, and told us once a month to evaluate ourselves on whether we'd changed. So that's how we did it. Jill will verify. And you wouldn't be surprised, but we all scored ourselves very high. Meanwhile, the business model was not being implemented very well. So I had this job where we were working with each one of the stores on how to understand buy-in and then have the skills to actually do their roles differently. Essentially, that's what I was doing. And we had two stores in Detroit at the time that had grand opened at the same time, and they had just started comping. Okay, so they were 14 months old. The stores were 7 miles apart, same size, same layout, same assortment, same pricing strategy, same everything. And when they started comping, one of the stores was comping positive, high single digits, and the other store was comping negative. And we were racking our brains, trying to figure out what the heck was wrong. And we were doing all the stuff that you might think we were doing. Oh, we may have the assortment must be wrong. The ads must not be getting to the right place. We must have some local competitor, so our pricing must be screwed up. We're trying to figure all this stuff out. Nothing's footing. We cannot figure out why the performance of the stores is different. So we're in the market, and I go into both of the stores in the same day. I walk into the store that's comping negative, and I'm going to use a technical term here. The vibe felt soul dead. That's a universal retail term, and you guys know what it means, because you can feel it when you go into retail stores yourself. Felt soul dead. You talk to people, not a lot of eye contact, just doing their stuff. You find your way to the store manager, and guess what we had? We had our own version of Bill running one of our stores. You go 7 miles down the road to the store that's comping positive, what do you think we found? Yeah, it's got a different vibe to it. You walk in, you can feel an energy, you can see a pace. People have perspectives. You watch the engagement. You don't have to talk to anybody. You can see the pace and the energy and the engagement. Wind your way to the store manager. What do you think we had? We had a Best Buy version of Larry. It's like, Jill mentioned that I spent time outside the United States. And one of the things I most wondered was whether outside the United States the same idea would hold. Like, all things equal, how much of the performance of a store is tied to who the leadership team is, what they believe, and how involved the team members really are, like with their own perspectives, in serving a mission larger than themselves? How much do they buy into it? So, like, will this hold? And I was particularly interested in whether in China it would be true. Like, would the same thing happen? Would all things equal, over time, the performance of a store have more to do with the people in the store and who the leader was? Or would it have something to do with other things, real estate, location, all the other things that we all have to know and are an important part of what we do? What would you guess? What would you guess? You guys are not going to get extra credit if you don't talk. Didn't they tell you that too? You have to come for extra credit, you have to write a paper, and you have to participate. We're keeping track. What do you think we'd find? You would find the same. You're absolutely right. How you do it in Nanjing, China might be different than how you do it in Waco, Texas. But the idea is absolutely the same. About 5 years ago, I was in Bayport, Louisiana. And the store was an anomaly for us because it was growing like crazy. I mean, disproportionately more than the whole rest of the market was. So I went to the store, mostly to congratulate him and thank him. But I met this guy, maybe 20 years old. He was just a young guy. His name was Billy Brooks, working in Bayport, Louisiana in the computing department. So I was talking to Billy about what these guys are doing to grow their store. And he said, oh, our store serves seafarers. I said, what does that even mean? And he said, no. We have these ships, these cargo ships that come in, and they come in on a regular schedule. And he knew the schedule. And he said, they come in, and then when they have a certain amount of time off the ship, they come with these lists of stuff that they want to buy and they want to take home with them. And they come flying in here. And so after a little bit of time, you know, we kind of noticed that was happening, and so now we serve these guys, And we have some ideas about how to do that, and so our business is growing like crazy. So I said, well, how did you guys come up with that? He said, well, what do you mean, how do we come up with that? I said, well, how did you kind of come up with the idea? And he said, well, I mean, I wait on them every day. So I just kind of paid attention, and then I started asking them, like, who are you guys? And then we just kind of took it from there to where now, you know, they'll kind of email ahead of time the stuff they're going to want, and then, you know, I get it ready, and so we have this whole little thing we do around this segment that we've named Seafarers. So I said, well, how did you go from having the idea of it or kind of noticing that this was happening to it actually turning into your store growing so much? And he says, oh, that's easy. My manager asked me. I said, what do you mean manager asked you? He said, yeah, he asked me. Like, what ideas do you have on how we could grow our store? And so I told him. And so then I told him what we should do, and then he helped me do it. So that's what we're doing. Bayport, Louisiana, same idea. It holds everywhere. Everywhere. Anywhere there's something remarkable happening for some period of time, it always comes down to the same things. It always comes down to who the people are. It comes down to what's the leadership point of view that's at play, and what does that leader think their job actually is? Are they helping their team members find their way into serving a mission larger than themselves? Do they believe the people on the team have value to add? Do they believe they have insight? What do they think their job is, and what do they think they're actually serving? Are they more of a Larry model, or are they more of a Bill model? More often than not, it's some version of a Larry model. The other thing that's always the same, in any place where it's remarkable, you have individuals who are serving something and believing in something beyond whatever the task at hand happens to be. They tend to know what they're good at. They tend to be confident. They tend to have perspectives on things. As I like to say, they tend to be showing up as their full-blown messy selves with their whole point of view on what they think needs to happen. And they're working with somebody who sees it as their job to take that energy and point of view and aim it at a customer need in a way that it grows the business. And the combination of those two things, what the leadership point of view is, who the people are, how engaged, involved they are, what mission they're serving, and the environment they create together that you all know you can feel when you go anywhere. It's electric or it's not. Anytime something remarkable is happening, for a period of time, there's some version of that happening. I guarantee it. I guarantee it's not a killer ad strategy with a team that doesn't have a soul, because that'll never, ever, ever produce that kind of energy that you all know you can feel. Now, you do not have to have a job with a made-up title, which mine is, and you know that based on how long it is with Jill's introduction. You do not have to have a job like this one in a publicly traded big retail company for the point to be relevant at all. But what I will say is that anything you're contemplating for a retail career, any avenue in you're contemplating, any functional area you're thinking about, any different retailer you're thinking about, what you will be signing up for, and you should do it knowingly if you want to be happy and great at it, you will be signing up for a human endeavor. Because that's what these jobs are. In the end, retail jobs are human jobs. Because everything else is made up. It's made up. Retail jobs are groups of people coming together in an artificial corporation with a made-up name with made-up colored shirts. Ours are blue, Target's are red. With made-up job titles, which you guys know because if you're in retail, they change all the time anyway. With made-up fixtures, with made-up store design, with made-up pricing. It's all made up. The only thing that's real, that's not made up, are the people. The people of the company serving the other people, their customers, and trying to create something remarkable. That's what these jobs are. And that's what these jobs are, whether you're a store manager, or whether you're in merchandising, or whether you're in supply chain. They're all people jobs. Now, Jill would like me, I bet, to stay on the topic of retail careers, but I'm going to allow myself to go off for just 1 second on this, for what it's worth. Everything in the world is the same thing. The world is a human endeavor. Everything else is just different constructs of groups of people coming together to try to accomplish something. So sometimes we call it a publicly traded company. Sometimes we call it a not-for-profit. Sometimes we call it a church. Sometimes we call it a little league team. Sometimes we call it a family. Sometimes we call it a friendship. All those are different labels for the same thing. Groups of people, something in common, trying to create something meaningful. Our team members in China want the same thing our team members in the United States want, the same thing our team members in Mexico want, the same thing our team members in Canada want. And I think it's what most people want. They want their voice to be heard. They want to know their work matters. They want to do meaningful things. Most people want to create great opportunity for themselves. And when they have families, they want to create opportunities for their kids to have a better life than they had. And they want to know when they're done that it mattered. And we spend a lot of time in our careers. Some of us longer than others, but you will too. So what I offer up is, in my view, the world, organizations, the companies you all either work at today or are thinking about going to, need a lot more people in a whole bunch of roles who actually understand what this is about. Understand that the jobs and the world are about people doing remarkable things with other people to create meaningful outcomes. Companies are dying for leaders who actually have that point of view and actually believe they're serving something more than themselves. You can help with that. I think it was Abraham Lincoln. If I get this wrong, you guys can put it in the feedback form. I think it was Abraham Lincoln who said the best thing about the future is it comes one day at a time. Do you guys think I'm right about that? Somebody will Google me. I think it was Lincoln. I'll take that one step further. To break it down beyond the future coming one day at a time, it actually comes one moment at a time. Really, that's how your life unfolds. So what we do in the moment, ultimately, adds up to what our life story becomes. So I'll give you, and I'll close on just one piece of advice, and then I'm going to take your questions and we'll shape this in the way you guys want to. My one piece of advice. Engage in the moments with the intention of creating something remarkable with people and for people. Everything else, the title, the function, it matters, but it matters secondarily. Engage in the moments of your career and your life with the intention of creating something remarkable with people and for people. And I guarantee you, while you're doing it, and when it's done, and when you look back on your career, and you're more on this side of your career than you're on that side of your career, you will have had a wild ride that will be at times moving you to tears, at other times making you want to put your head in a vise and screw it tight, and everything in between. But one thing I am positive you will have the most important thing, which is you will have a very happy life story. Because the happiness is in the moments of working with other people to create something remarkable. It's not in the technical skill. Okay? All right, it's going to be your guys' turn. It's 8 o'clock. I'm close to on time, is that right? So it's now going to be your guys' turn to work. Okay, so pencils out. Do you guys have pencils? Get your phones out. Jill's going to give you an assignment, and then I'll stand up here and take your questions all night long until you're done. Nothing is off limits, I'll tell you that, but I'm going to qualify it by saying one thing. I will answer you directly and honestly anything you ask me, but I am one out of 125,000 people at Best Buy, so there is a very high likelihood that everybody will not agree with what I tell you. But I will tell you what I think nonetheless, so ask anything you want, okay? So Jill, will you help us with the assignment? And thanks, you guys. You've been a great audience.
Okay, so you discussed aiming the energy as a manager. I'm just wondering how you channeled that into when you were part of a corporate team, like when you worked in HR, just kind of what skills you used from that.
Thanks for asking that, because I picked the store environment as a place to kind of tell the story because it's something we all can experience. But the same thing absolutely applies. I've spent now more of my career at a corporate office than I have out in a store environment, and it's the absolute same thing. You walk through building, you walk through different departments, and they have a different energy and vibe to them, and it's the same idea. It's based on almost always who the people on the team are, you know, how are they in connecting to something larger than themselves? Do they feel like they're part of something big? Do they know their thoughts, their opinions count? And who's the leader, and how does the leader orchestrate that in a way that the environment works? And it is, your question is important because it is equally important in any functional area as it is in one of the channels or customer touch points, because in essence, it's the same idea. I mean, what you're doing in these jobs is you're basically trying to do more with the talent you have on your team than what your competitors can do with theirs. I mean, that's it. You know, what are we doing at Best Buy? We're trying to do more with the talent of the people at Best Buy than Amazon or Walmart or Apple or Target or anybody else can do with theirs. That's it. And sometimes when I say that, people will be like, no, Shari, differentiation or how you win isn't just about people. Like, for example, Amazon's fabulous because their technology's fabulous. Correct. Where did their technology come from? It did not come down on the tablets, as in the Moses tablets, not as in technology tablets. It didn't come from the tablets. It came from people. Same idea. People have to be inspired, clear on the mission they're serving, invited, expected to participate in working with people who do a world-class job of orchestrating that, aiming it at the customer problem you're trying to solve, and then growing your business as a result. So it applies very much in every single area, same idea. Thanks for asking. Very smart question. I think somebody over here had their hand up. Back here. Excellent. Hello. Hey, would you, so you guys know me, would you mind introducing yourself just so I can at least have your name?
Yeah, I'm Sarah.
Hi, Sarah. Let's get you a mic. I did not get your name.
My name is Jack Moore.
Jack?
Yep.
Thank you for the question.
Thank you. Okay, so one of the things that my table was thinking about, well, the first thing that we came up with was how do you create a moment online versus how you create a moment in the store?
Smart. Okay, you want to take that first? Is that the only
I
thing
you're
thinking
to
about,
you.
Or you got more than one thing you're thinking about back there? So how do you create a moment online versus in a store? Excellent question. Same idea, though. The idea is the same. If what you're trying to do in a one-on-one interaction with another human being, in retail in particular, is you're trying to understand who's the person that I'm interacting with, so like who are you as a consumer, what are you actually trying to do with the product you think you're going to buy? And my job is to make absolutely sure that I understand you, what you're trying to do, and then I help you do that in the best possible way, and then I maybe in my best moments also inspire you a little bit with what's possible that you didn't even know. That's what you try to do in a one-on-one human interaction. Same idea on the website. You just have to figure out how to do it with a digital interface rather than with a human interface. But it's the same idea. And the way you do it from a leadership perspective is very similar. You help the people that are designing those interfaces, the people who are designing the experience, understand ultimately what mission we're trying to serve. Why are we trying to serve it? You help them understand what they're individually great at, how they contribute to doing that, and together you create an environment where that's what you're doing, and you're putting it in service to your customers, you're watching how they're reacting, and you're learning very quickly. So for some people would say maybe that's easier or harder to do than a one-on-one interaction. I suppose it depends on, you know, where you've spent the vast majority of your life. But the idea is the same. First, clarity of customer mission, engaging team members so that they know what they're great at and how they contribute, leaders and team members who are creating environments where you're serving something larger than yourself, putting it in service to the customers, growing your business as a result. Does that answer your question?
I believe so.
If it doesn't, you stay right with me. You can ask a follow-up if you want to.
No. I mean, I guess I'll just mention some of the other questions that we were thinking about.
I'll take them.
So one of the other gals sitting here, she was wondering about how, especially when you're in a low point in your business and things aren't going so great, and like, how do you spark that transformation in your business? And what is it like experiencing that?
Yeah, that's a great question.
Yeah.
Boy, we've had a number of them over the years at Best Buy. I mean, we've had a fair number of near-death experiences. Let me try to answer that a little bit from a kind of a personal lens, I guess. First of all, let me say this. I think each of us has within us the ability to be Bill and the ability to be Larry. So on my best days, I hope I look more like Larry. On my worst days, I probably look worse than Bill, you know, where I'm stressed, I'm making statements, I'm using the number one overused leadership anxiety management technique, which is I'm dumping it on somebody who works on my team so I feel better. You know, so first of all, I would say we all kind of have the full range of that in us, and part of the job is to become self-aware, to understand in the moment, like, what am I doing, and am I getting the best out of this situation or not? You know, the ability to correct pretty quickly, and to deploy the most important but dramatically underutilized technique in leadership, which is the do-over. Like, hey, that interaction wasn't very good. I could have been a lot better. Let's try that again. So things like that can help even it out. But I think for me, the things that got me through the darkest days at Best Buy, and honestly, you guys, there were some tough ones when it was pretty rough, and, you know, you're driving home every day. For me, you know, a company that I've given, you know, 20-some years of my life to, and I love it. Trying to figure out how you get from here to there, and you're wondering how that's going to happen. And there were days when the only thing I could do was show up the next day and try to make it better. And show up the next day and try to make it better. But I think the way at least I get through that when my energy's not quite where it should be is I go back to who am I actually serving, and I try to spend more time there. So for me, when I'm running out of gas, I've usually gotten disconnected somewhere with who I'm actually serving and why the work matters. And I'll go out and spend time in stores. I'll put a headset on with our customer care folks and listen to customers. It doesn't take too long when you get out with your team to get re-inspired and reminded of why you're doing what you're doing. I think where leaders go wrong is you either never really understood who you were serving in the first place, as your career grows, you can get a little sideways on that. What I mean by that is when you're earlier in your career, I think pretty often you kind of behave like you really don't have a lot to lose because you don't. You know, you're growing your career and you're trying things out. As your career grows and your jobs get bigger and your title gets bigger, and sometimes what can happen is your identity as a person can get tied to what your title is. or how much money you make, or, you know, things that aren't really real, and they certainly don't make people happy. And so you can start kind of showing up every day trying to maintain your title or your role and making people above you happy so that you don't lose anything. That tends to be kind of a recipe for disaster and unhappiness. So I think that's the other thing. You know, if you're feeling like you're not super energized, there might be a good likelihood that you've either forgotten who you serve or you're chasing the wrong thing. So getting a little regrounded on what you're trying to accomplish with your life sometimes can help too. So I guess that's what I would say. I think courage matters a lot more than confidence. And so sometimes it's just about continuing to show up and give it your best effort until the physics of the situation maneuver enough where you can actually get a better outcome, you know, just like it is in the whole rest of your life. So I think confidence is kind of overrated. You know, there are days I'm driving in going, today's the day everybody in the world is going to find out I have no idea what I'm doing. And then there are other days I drive in and I'm like, I so got this. And that just, you know, I'm not really in control of that. But I do think what you're in control of is, you're in control of your own courage and what you kind of put yourself into. So I would say that too, you know. Stay on the courage front and don't worry too much about whether you feel confident or not. Just be courageous. Keep going forward. I think that's what I would say. That's a good question. Thanks for asking.
No, yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I think we got some hands back here. Hi there.
Hi, I'm Calvin.
I didn't quite get that.
I'm Calvin.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you.
What can I do for you?
So is there like a specific turning point when you kind of realize your whole philosophy on the people and, kind of how that all got together?
I used to work with our CEO a number of years ago is a gentleman named Brad Anderson. Brad's one of the finest human beings I've ever met in my life. And I remember him saying one time, if you're lucky, you got one sermon in you. And you find your whole, you know, you kind of spend your whole life working your way to that one sermon. And I didn't really totally understand it at the time. I have a better sense of it now. So I think, I don't know that there was like a, you know, kind of a crucible moment where it all, you know, like I woke up and it was like, ah, this is my point of view. I think it more evolves over time. I think the more you have to think about it, share it with people, it gets clearer. But I would say what I can tell you as a defining moment was, you know, probably 4 or 5 years ago when, you know, we were in a pretty rough situation at Best Buy. And that'll test you pretty good in terms of what price you're willing to pay to actually make whatever your dream is a reality. So there were a lot of days there where, you know, you kind of had to decide, and I had to decide, you know, is the dream worth it? Because it was pretty tough. And I think maybe that experience of, you know, having the dream force you to pay an extreme price for it, maybe for me put a good definition to it. So when I sit there today and I hear Jill talk about, we haven't fully turned the company around yet, we got so much work to do, but when I hear Jill talk about we got it stabilized and some of the stuff that's going the right direction for us, at this point that feels pretty good. And maybe that's a reminder of, you know, that when it's really tough, that's usually when your dream gets tested the most and probably the most important time to double down on it, I guess. So maybe that's what I'd say.
Perfect. Thank you.
Thanks for the question. Big dreams have a way of making you pay a big price for them. So just be prepared for that. I think that's what I'd say.
Hi, I'm going to piggyback off of Sarah here.
Sure.
I'm Elsie Driver. Hello. So I manage a retail store at the Mall of America.
Fabulous. Where do you work?
At Madewell.
Good for you.
So as you know, working in a retail store, I'm not there all the time. So
yep.
We're open right now.
Yep.
So from your perspective.
So are we.
Yeah, right? It's all the time. So from your perspective, what are some ways that we can teach emerging leaders in our stores and all of our associates to be more like Larry's when
yeah.
we're not there and instead of just telling them they have to be
this
like Larry's?
This is so the question, you know? It's like, what's the holy grail in scale retail? It's like every store having a great general manager and great, it's like, you're chasing it your whole life. I think it's kind of, you kind of started to answer it yourself when you used the compliance word. I mean, I think the way you have to do it is you have to, I mean, you really do have to kind of foster a commitment where the people on the team are as invested in what you're all trying to accomplish together as you are. So that when you're not there, you know they may not do it the same way you do it. You know, if you've done a good job, they'll know what you care about. But they'll also know that you want them to be themselves. You know, so you'll have some parameters. You'll all be kind of aligned on what your dream is for your store and what you're trying to accomplish. Your team members will know their role in it. They'll know what they're great at and why that totally matters. Parameters for how you want to accomplish it. And then the more they own it, you know, and it's your team's dream of what you're trying to accomplish, not just yours, the higher the likelihood that when you're not there, they're working as hard for it as when you're there. I think when it's too compliant, you know, it's, and you can get this sometimes with really strong GMs who have, you know, who are drivers, and they can do everything. They know how to do all the jobs. They know how to do all the jobs better than everybody else. And the store is small enough that sometimes they can do that, and they can get away with it until they're not there, and then nothing happens. And so I think you really, the better you are in terms of knowing operationally how a store has to work, the better you have to be at making sure that your team members are as invested as you are and that they're driving it when you're not there because they have a sense of ownership and an accomplishment of what, you know, you're trying to get done. It's one of the hardest things to do, especially, like I said, for leaders who are really good at doing all the stuff. You know, that's the tough one. It's a great question. Congratulations on all your success, by the way. Okay. Oh, my God, there's three people raising their hands, so how do you guys want to handle this? Jill says we got one.
I'll go.
I like that. I said, how do you guys want to handle this? I'll go. That was solid. Okay, let's go, and then I'll hang out, and I'll take your question. Okay, perfect.
Over here. My name's Amanda Morell. I'm the district merchandiser for Urban Outfitters.
Did you say Amanda?
Yes.
Hi, Amanda.
My biggest question is, what are the main attributes you look for when you select your people for your team?
Depends on the role. Did you guys hear the question? What are the attributes that we look for? So I would say, generally speaking, it depends on the role. But generally speaking, we're looking for people who can fall in love with what we're trying to get done, who can fall in love with serving other people. We're pretty good with, we'll work with you on technical skill. We hire for technical skill, obviously. So if you're coming in and, you know, you want to work in accounting, we're not going to say, well, if you have no technical skill in accounting, we'll teach you everything. And we do some of that. But generally speaking, we assume some level of whatever the technical requirements are for the job. But then we're looking for people who have the same kinds of things I just talked about. Fall in love with the mission. They want to serve other people. They want to be part of a team. They want to be part of creating something larger than themselves. They're resilient. Sense of humor helps. For us, competitive helps. We're pretty competitive in a good way. Personally, if I'm up against two candidates, I'm always going to pick somebody that I think is a better cultural fit over somebody that's got great technical skill. But it's like, oh my God, they're gonna either kill themselves or somebody else here because this environment's going to make them nuts. So I pay a lot of attention to whether I think they're going to be a fit for what we're trying to get done and whether they're going to love it or whether it's going to make them crazy. So generally speaking, that's kind of how we think about it. Okay, Jill says we're done, but how about this? I'll hang out, and then if you guys want to ask your questions, you can come up here and I'll answer them for you. Okay, thanks a lot. You guys have been great. Thank you.